Who is the delegate from Indonesia? Any delegate from Indonesia? Okay, good. Bagaimana Pak? Bisa berbicara bahasa Indonesia? So when I was in Indonesia, the beauty of being in Indonesia was that I learned the language for 10 months and then I studied my entire course in that language. So the interesting part of being all over is that you learn different languages. Good evening to all of you. It's a great, great evening for me, and I was just discussing with Dr. Amrita that years back I wish there was something called as Modern United Nations, and I want to actually relive my student life. The first time I had an international exposure and I was referred to not as a delegate but as a representative of India was in the year 1992 when I represented India NCC to a youth conference in UK. That was way back in 92. And the interesting part and the exposure that I got there, it still carries me in great stead whenever I interact. So these kind of conferences, these kind of things are very, very informative and educational as such. Thereafter, I had an exposure in the High Commission of India in Namibia and also in the Embassy of India in Indonesia. And what I learned out of MUN, I'm going to tell you 3 points which I feel are very, very important and are takeaways from forums such as Modern United Nations. So the first thing that I feel that a particular delegate needs to do when he is going to be a delegate of a particular country working on a particular issue is that he needs to do a lot of research, am I right? Whatever it could be, but there is no substitute to good knowledge. And this research that you need to do as a delegate from a specific committee and what your country stand has been is very, very important, and that gives you confidence. The second point I want to make is that our art of articulation, just for the knowledge of the audience, if you ask me honestly, speaking is a natural ability, writing is an acquired ability. Am I right or wrong? But over the period of years, from our education, from the kind of environment that we come from, somewhere deep down our speaking abilities, they take a back seat and we become more into the writing part. So in the second point I want to say, in occasions like this, Modern United Nations, your articulation of your thoughts is something that you need to pay attention to. And like Ma'am was saying, how do you present your point? What kind of a communicator are you? How effective, how emphatic are you going to put your points across? And that comes with a lot of confidence and knowing how to speak in public. And when they say public speaking, it could be your articulation to a group of 1 person, 2 persons, 5 people, 10 people, whatever it could be. Am I right? And if you do this public speaking as a performance, you could be in a little bit of hazy area. If you could do this public speaking as a conversation, I'm sure you'll all feel more confident. Am I right or not? So the photographs and the AE that was presented was a proof by itself that most of you were so passionate and involved in putting across your point that most of the hands are going up and down and, you know, and they're not being captured on screen, but Kavi SLV, you know, all those kinds of things would have happened. So that's the second part, that you have to be a good communicator. And the third point, an important point I want to bring about, and then I'm going to try and connect it to you, the good leadership. The third important point is, if you realize, as a delegate of a particular country, there is already a homework or a background or a history and a policy of your country that has been projected. It is very important in life to be a good follower, to be a good leader. You cannot just become a good leader out of nowhere. You have to be a follower. And to be a good follower, you need to understand that there is a difference between activism and administration. You can get good activists by saying a lot of things and putting across what your points of views are, but once a decision is taken, once a policy is framed, once a timing for getting together, gathering at XYZ time, or having such kind of things in your canteen, once a decision is taken, it is up to us as leaders of whichever organization we are going to lead in future to convince those people that this is the right thing. The first two which I said, that is the research and the public speaking skills, can come through a lot of training, a lot of competency happening, and you can improve on these. But the third thing comes about your attitude. You got to be aware that everything is not as per your liking all the time, but when you stand on stage and you represent as a delegate of XYZ country talking on a particular issue, all you need to do is support that with full conviction. There is no point speaking something here than going outside and putting an entirely diametrically opposite viewpoint, because I thought so. I have nothing to say because the delegate of India wants to say this. Am I right? Is that the correct way of speaking in the MUN? So it is not about you, it is about what is the policy. And the policies and the way the organization needs to go forward is also decided by a collective group. This attitude you need to develop. We are a country which is got a demographic dividend as of now. You are the future of the country. And to run any country, any organization, it could be a school, NGO, social service organization, taxi stand, register, you name an organization. To run an organization, you need doers. You do not need only people who would be cynical about what's happening. Oh, they should, hey, Ramana, who would like me, sir? Hey, brother, who like me, sir? Cash is there, bankers are there. So we want people who are doers, because leadership is all about doing something. And things, the fence sitters are not real good leaders. Oh, it is not rain. You know, it is like that. Oh, it didn't rain, but your department said it is India Khara. Oh, it rained, but the main department said it is not India Khara department. Right? So we tend to get into these things because the first two are very important for us. We have the articulation skills, we have the research, we have the knowledge. So we tend to maybe get into the loop of being cynical more often than being positive. And in today's age and stage, it is important that we have a freedom of expression, but we also need to know how much of freedom and how did we get this freedom, because if somebody doing something, maybe few generations back. Leadership, if you ask me, as a youth leadership, I was saying, telling you that it is all about doing. The second thing that you need to understand in any kind of leadership context is you've got to know where the nuts and bolts are. You have to understand how difficult it is to even organize small little functions, and here we are talking of almost running big organizations and big countries, right? So we have to know how does that particular thing function. And to for that particular thing to function, if you ask me what has been my guiding principle and the you know kind of a lighthouse for me, somewhere there is a bada koi nahi hai. The day you understand what I am trying to say, there is nobody bigger than the organization. Then it is Sangathan se bada koi nahi, sir, lekin mera Sangathan to office school hai. So as long as you understand this, that you got to be a good soldier. You don't have to join the army, air force, navy, police to be a good soldier. Soldier is a bent of mind. You have to be a soldier for the organization that you work for. Today, if your role is as a student, you got to be a good soldier for this school. Tomorrow, when you pass out and you go into a college, you got to be a good soldier for that college. And then it could be an MBA or a lawyer or an architect. Join an MNC or join Tata or whatever you want to join, whatever is your best profession that you want to decide, that's fine. But once you decide that profession, it is that particular organization that you need to be a good soldier. And we are all going to be good soldiers first, and then we can decide whether we want to be leaders or what do we want to be, analysts or leaders or whatever it could be. So followership is more important, and just follow sometimes. It's also healthy. It's also nice to just keep quiet and listen. Because courage is not only in standing up and speaking. Courage is also in sitting down and listening to what the other guy is saying. And in today's halabullah and raising your voices and what we see on TV, right? People think that a good debate means you have to raise your voice and keep talking. Half the time you don't know what somebody is trying to say, right? So always remember, I close my address and maybe take on a question or so if there is time. But always remember, you must always talk. You must always talk as if you are right. And you must always listen as if the other person is right. If you can pick this thing, in your life you will find that you will be an excellent communicator. People will come and really respect you for your communication skills, the way you can connect to people, the way you make your impact. And finally, we are here as a school to make an impact. Your purpose is to learn something from this school, make a foundation so that tomorrow you can go and make an impact on the world, make it a better place. That is our dream, and that is the dream each one of you should see. India is an absolute safe hands. You guys are great. You are going to take us to our next, absolute next level. So we as all these people are sitting here, we are absolute trust in your capabilities. Never let anybody tell you, millennials, RC generation, Dalgi generation, Hamara time.
That has been my experience, and I can tell you one thing because of my international experience. As much as we may like to say about our projections to the world, and we have a lot of debate on that and how what we know and what we don't know. You take any Indian across the world, and specifically if he goes from India, the competition here is so much that only the best will go. So whenever you go to an international conference, attendance, whenever you are going to attend any interaction with any international community, my advice to you, my suggestion to you, and my confidence to you is, don't ever think there is something lacking in you. Look into the eye of the other guy and tell what you think about your country, what you think about an issue, and let me tell you, it is the right one.
Okay, what did I do? So, someday I request man to invite me again and tell you what are my secret masala box, I call it. I have a masala box for success. Every household is a masala box, right? But every dal tadka is different in every house because we have different masalas. So I have my masala box, I come, but one thing, if you were to ask me what did I do, I'll just sum it up and say something like, you would have fire in your belly. Okay, the most important thing you got to have is you got to have fire in your belly. And if you read, you go back home and maybe your parents will answer you why Ayurveda talks about why fire in the belly and not aspiration in the heart, why this word has come. You understand that the whole thing happens here. The whole fire is here, and that is why we are alive as such. So to answer your question, if you have fire in the belly, nothing is impossible. Thank you very much, and have a great day.